It was the morning before the winter solstice, in Paris, France, on Saturday, December 20th, 1980, in the 14th arrondissement near a quarter in the south known as Montparnasse. It was a cold, gray winter day, and Véronique Antiphon was somewhat anxious as she went into labor, as she and her then-partner Patrick received word that the hospital's pipes were undergoing emergency maintenance and that they would have no water at their disposal for the delivery. Despite some apprehension, she made it into Beaudeloc Hospital in time. And at 11:30 in the morning, Guillaume Desvart was brought safely into the world. Every generation, as the late George Carlin once remarked, is graced with a few winners and a whole lot of losers. And if it can be said that a person could be winning at the game of life, Guillaume Desvart epitomized exactly what that would look like. When life presented him with opportunities, he took them. When given the chance at a new adventure in a new country, he leapt at it. He brought people together when the world forced them apart.
Dear Mazarin Fazer, America is a vast and strange place. Everything is bigger here, and there is so much to explore. Yet I believe I am finding my place. The people here have been kind to me, except for my neighbor Chad. That guy is a jerk.
His parents, Véronique and Patrick, were 26 years old at the time. Both felt happy and anxious to be parents, but were also mindful of the challenges that a work-life balance could create and how to navigate them. They had arranged his delivery at the Beaudeloc Hospital because Véronique attended her studies as a medical student across the street. Guillaume's birth was easier than many. He was healthy and the delivery was quick. But due to the holiday season, the hospital was behind on providing meals, and Véronique had to wait at least a day before she would receive one. While she recovered, Patrick could be found napping in various hospital beds in the vicinity, as, being a nurse himself, he held a familiarity with the medical system that others might not. By the time they got the water back in working order, they celebrated his arrival into the world and began their lives together with a bath in the sink.
France in the 80s was in the midst of a big political and cultural change. The Socialist Party was coming into power, led by newly elected president François Mitterrand. Perhaps people had a lot of hope that things would become more egalitarian, and while many of the changes they hoped for never came to pass, and some people did in fact become disillusioned, the country's progressivism was still a boon to young Guillaume's life. Daycare and preschool programs there, for instance, are usually free and of high quality. They would end up molding Guillaume in many fundamental ways into the person he would become.
Hey, you can light that if you prefer. It's not going to bother us or the crew.
Oh, no, I'm not a smoker.
A few mere months later, young Guillaume would get his first tastes of social life. He was to attend a nursery in Paris's 12th arrondissement, where his parents lived, in a big fourth floor, typically styled Parisian apartment, with no elevator. He could barely speak, but was already discovering a new community of budding friendships. It would foreshadow the ease he would have in making them throughout most of his life. He smiled, a lot, and his curiosity shone through as a very young boy. Uncharacteristic for many his age, he did not shy away from approaching people and animals. He seemed to live his early life without reservations.
Free Preschool in France may begin for children as young as 2 years old, and true to form, Guillaume didn't waste any time. He was two when he started school at Boulogne-Billancourt, I believe is how it's pronounced. I believe it's where they manufacture them shiny Renault cars. It's a lively, diverse part of Paris, and it really kicked off what would be a life devoted to learning and diversity and liveliness. Can I get a retake?
It wasn't long before Guillaume would begin his primary schooling in Juvisy-sur-Orge, a small Parisian suburb where he lived in the house his great-grandparents built in 1910. He spent weeks with his mother there, and weekends in Boulogne-Billancourt, with Patrick and his younger sisters Émilie, born in 1985, and Élise, born in 1988. Then later in Paris's 13th arrondissement, near the heart of Paris's Chinatown, a boy about town at a young age. Playtime for Guillaume rarely consisted of television, instead preferring the company of a good book, full of fairy tales and mysteries, or of his favorite comics like Tintin and Asterix. One of his very telling favorite toys was his 1980 Fisher-Price cassette player, a hipster's collector item if ever one existed. He would use it to listen to stories and to play his favorite music for he and his new siblings.
Guillaume was only 4 by the time the first of his sisters was born, but he slotted into the role of the big brother much more quickly than you might imagine. You could tell by his body language alone that he thought of himself as the protector. A few years later, he once told a deadbeat boyfriend that they'd better well off, or that he'd their eyes and the they got the idea.
Despite his early scholastic success, he was not always adept at sports. He preferred the leisurely stroll to the strenuous run, but it never kept him from trying. He tried his hand at judo, fencing, and horseback riding, but none of them would come close to rivaling his only real athletic passion, soccer, or, as it's simply known everywhere else but in the US, football. At first on the field, his parents noticed that he seemed to be strafing around the ball, rather than engaging with it. So when he eventually got the chance to play, he personally took the role of goalie. He especially loved the goalie's gloves that he got to wear. He eventually shared this passion, as a fan, with his father, who took him at a young age to watch Paris Saint-Germain at Parc des Princes.
Guillaume really was an ambassador for the game in later years. Don't know an offside kick from a slide tackle? He's got your answer. What's the difference between a red and a yellow card? He'd explain. Why are these fans singing at this particular moment, at this particular stadium, at this particular game? He'd break it down for you. I've heard he's converted at least half a dozen American football fans into European football fans. In this country, that's really saying something.
During these same years, with his Fisher-Price cassette player eventually giving way to his first Walkman, and then his first CD player, Guillaume had discovered another, truer, lifelong passion. One he could take with him anywhere, one that would accompany him even in his darkest moments. Music. At the Music Conservatory in Juvisy-sur-Orge, he was foisted into piano, like so many children his age. And like many other children still, it didn't take. But he did discover the drums.
Listen, there's not a lot of recorded material to suggest that this man was much of a dancer. It's possible, but the record is spotty, alright? There isn't even a lot of indication that he could or ever would be a singer. In fact, he once subdued a colleague of his for suggesting that he dance like no one's watching and sing like no one's listening. He despised word art for what it's worth as well. But what is undeniable, and we have one of the 90s most successful records, at least of its genre to prove it, is that he had rhythm. He could find the beat, and he did, often.
Under the tutelage of his professor, jazz musician Frédéric Fermin, he would go on to play the drums in concerts and recordings, showing up in an album that Pitchfork has since labeled as the greatest cult marching band record to ever blow up the drumline scene. The self-titled album from the group De Doudang, or From Where? Crazy, was only one of his multiple drumming accomplishments. France at this time was considered to be undergoing a cultural golden age. People even referred to it as the disco days. However, there is a common sentiment in both America and in France that the 80s and 90s were a precarious time for fashion in general, but for hair in particular. Guillaume was certainly at risk. Just like every boy in the 80s and 90s, he could have gone on to commit absolute atrocities in the name of fashion and hair care, especially when he conceded to what is already considered to be a risky fashion proposition, the bowl cut. But Guillaume pulled it off. Gimme head with hair, long, beautiful hair, shining, gleaming, steaming, flaxen, waxen. And it really was a testament to his charisma and natural good looks, because nobody could rock it like he could. Eventually, when it came time to graduate into different styles, Guillaume would grow naturally concerned, as his golden blonde locks were a prize to him. His mother would go on to take the step of consulting some of Paris's finest stylists to make sure that his hair would survive the transition to a new style. It would stick with him until the end. Guillaume had a yearning to travel the world, fostered by the relationships he was privileged to share with his grandparents on both sides. On his mother's side, he would spend vacations with Roger and Françoise, with whom he would explore the mountains near Geneva, learn to ski, and where his grandmother's cooking would mold him into a lifelong gourmand in the most positive sense.
He had his palate shaped by classic French cooking. That included various stewed meats, beef prepared with elaborate sauces, but what really broke through to him was his grandmother's baking, particularly her cakes. He was a fiend for baked sweets, and that carried well into his adult life. It even led to a pretty sweet career later on. So get it? Sweet career. You see what I'm doing there?
On his father's side, Guillaume would broaden a deep connection with the south of France in a vacation home with Patrick and his wife Isabelle. On both sides of the family, their connection was indispensable. He called his grandfather's office the captain's quarters because of the captivating stories he would hear from him about his time in the French army, and because of the great library he would later endeavor to emulate contained within. He became wise to the world outside of Paris with Isabelle and her grandpa Gérald. His grandmothers Françoise and Albertine imparted a joie de vivre, which bolstered his individuality and charm. He shared books with everyone in the family. He vacationed in exotic places with them. He treasured his time in the island of New Caledonia, where he would vacation with his aunt and uncle, Genevieve and Philippe, and his cousin Martin, whose interests he would share in from an early age, and who secretly looked up to him for much of his life.
They would visit his uncle Francois and his children in New Caledonia, and Guillaume would simply have a magical time. On the way there, one magical occasion, he stopped off in the magical city of Bangkok, okay, where he was fascinated by the magical Buddhist temples and the magical smells of incense and the magical new sights and sensations there. Then, in New Caledonia, they would sail around to the various magical islands and atolls, sometimes sleeping below deck when the magical voyage would magically take more than a few magical days at a time. I tell you, it was magical.
Guillaume was easy to befriend and was an ambitious student. He was quick to jump into his primary and secondary schooling at an early age, and his thirst for knowledge carried him comfortably through the curriculum. But at that stage, he also felt somewhat out of place with his fellow students. His experiences in school were making him timid and reluctant to approach fellow children, a feature which nobody in his later years would be able to recognize. He decided on a fresh start, a do-over of his first year of secondary school, and began to grow into a confident teenager. So confident, in fact, that he developed a reputation among some of his teachers for talking back.
Let me tell you, this boy could be sassy, but but in a way that endeared him to people nonetheless. If one of his teachers ever veered from an objective subject to a subjective one, they weren't going to be safe from his opinion. One story tells of a particularly spicy moment where he was confronting a rather harsh art instructor. So he gets up, walks to the easel, and he grabs a brush. He proceeds to wow everybody in the room by drawing a perfect freehand circle.
Isn't that a story about Leonardo da Vinci?
Yeah. Who are you talking about?
Earlier on, because of his aptitude for more left-brain subjects, he was encouraged to pursue the sciences. But as was fitting with the years he had spent getting lost in the libraries of France, he stood firmly behind the idea of pursuing fields that pertain to literature and philosophy. After graduating high school, he began what is known as the Classe Préparatoire in the heart of Paris before continuing on to one of the world's most prestigious places of higher learning, the Sorbonne.
Guillaume's first calling, which would settle into a passion, was philosophy. Plato and Socrates would give way to Descartes and Rousseau, Seneca would give way to Kant, and so on and so on. And no subject was too impenetrable. He would just diagram the logical pathways of his thoughts on the subjects into the books themselves. He would frequently return back to the famous dictum uttered by Socrates that the unexamined life is not worth living. Guillaume did closely examine his life, once during the youthful probings of his upbringings, and then again in the halls of the Sorbonne. Then one more time when he would eventually go on to teach the subject. Here we are now, examining his life ourselves. So when you build upon rounds and rounds of examination, it's like his life was worth living to the exponential power of four. I think I'm starting to see into the singularity.
It wasn't long after his studies that he would begin as an intern for his first teaching assignment in the small northern town of Hirson. It was on such an assignment that the course of his life would change forever. Despite the stimulation of putting some of his advanced ideas into practice, Hirson, being a quiet community in a rural part of the country, didn't offer much in the way of excitement. It made him lonely. He reached out into an arena he hadn't spent much time in. Online dating.
There's very little record of his successes or lack thereof when he decided to put himself out there online. But what we do know is that when he connected with Laura Dixon, his accounts were immediately dismantled within 24 hours of their meeting. He was that sure. How do we know that? Well, I don't have any record of that either. All we have are records. Of not having records.
It was a whirlwind romance that would not end. Laura was to discover herself anew in northern France, having already fallen in love with the country once while living abroad in college. She would quickly fall in love with one of its most shining citizens. Needing a place where they could continue their roles as educators and get a taste of the culture they'd been deprived of, Guillaume had already started venturing out into the various northern towns when he settled in Lille, a place where they could begin to form a life together, and where he would solidify a host of lifelong friendships that would be with him in good times and bad. And of course, one of his second great loves was not far behind.
Au début des années 80, je me souviens des soirées où l'ambiance était chaude et les mecs rentraient. Stan Smith sur pied, le regard froid, il scrutait la salle.
One day, Laura opened the door to the new apartment that she and Guillaume now shared in Lille, and was surprised to see an equally surprised and somewhat pissed off little orange creature staring back. She had been lovingly plucked from a farm in La Rochelle from Patrick's partner Dominique, who had become a big part of Guillaume's family a few years earlier. Ninja was dear to them, Laura and Guillaume both. But according to Laura, Guillaume was her mother, father, and snuggle buddy insofar that Ninja could be snuggled. before anyone else, and from their first few days together.
Guillaume came to love his life in Lille. He loved the neighboring Belgium already, and it really was the perfect jumping off point for his new teaching job in a school called the Valenciennes, but also for the various journeys that he and Laura would go on together, which was so characteristic of his curious spirit. You know, places like Amsterdam, you know, Brussels, and London. And Bruges, and Lyon, and Antwerp, and Luxembourg. And Cologne. And Düsseldorf. And Bern, and...
On one occasion on their travels on a trip to Croatia, when the Icelandic volcano Eyjafjallajökull disrupted flight plans across not only Europe, but the entire Eastern Hemisphere, like a scene out of Home Alone, Laura and Guillaume befriended a group of Belgians who endeavored to make the trip home in a rented cargo van, with few breaks in between.
From their travels, they could see that they were a good team, okay? But it wasn't clear whether Lille was a place they could settle permanently. What was becoming clear was that it would soon be time for Laura to resume her life in California. So it would make sense for Guillaume to travel with her to the place where she grew up so that she could maybe make him feel like a part of her family as much as he had his. There had already been random visits to France from her mother Nancy, her Francophile father Jeff, and her eccentric and somewhat unconventional brother Colin. But now it was time to share California with him and see if it stuck.
The year was 2010. Once Laura went home to California, it soon became apparent to them both, as exhibited by their sonnet-like correspondences, that they couldn't remain separate for long. After hearing of a trip Laura's father had announced he would be taking to Italy later that year, Guillaume had made plans to intercept him there and ask him permission for his daughter's hand, an old-fashioned gesture that nonetheless brought the Dixon family great joy. Guillaume soon after planned to reunite with Laura on America's East Coast. The man who had taught himself English by watching reruns of Friends and The Simpsons was about to take a permanent step towards making California his new home. They were in Provincetown, on Massachusetts' Cape Cod, and records suggested that Guillaume was acting out of sorts all day. After a lovely seafood dinner, they walked into the New England air, where Guillaume was starting to break into a cold sweat. Laura at first believed he may be having shellfish poisoning when he kneeled down in an alleyway nearby and professed that he wanted to spend the rest of his days with her. She said yes. The two were now engaged to be married. But America wouldn't make it easy. Due to a minor clerical error, a potential mistake in the initial documents, or a plethora of other potential reasons, his first application for American citizenship was denied. At the time, the two were wrestling with their finances as it was. Desperate measures were now called for, as evinced by the drastic decision for Laura to move in with her brother and his partner Natalie in their new home in Daly City, just south of San Francisco, California. Fate worked out in their favor when they took the step of solidifying their union in Redwood City, California.
I went into a church. I stopped along the way.
It was time for Laura and Guillaume to start their lives in California together in Oakland, a city despite its ups and downs that he would come to love. They were married in France, at the base of the Pyrenees, where Guillaume's mother lived and worked. The joys of married life could now commence. They honeymooned in the Cinque Terre in Italy. While they were there, they got word of a private beach that promised a warm Mediterranean swim and beautiful view. To get there, they were told to take a pitch-black secret tunnel that after about 5 minutes of walking, started to make them nervous. But their fears were eventually allayed when they finally emerged onto a scene that held true to its promise, as well as an old hermit that lived on the beach and a gaggle of very revealing European tourists.
Life in the Bay Area was mostly very good to Guillaume. Perhaps not ironically, Guillaume's first job there was at a French macaroon shop, Chantal Guillaume. He was hired as a manager there and eventually even provided his soon-to-be sister-in-law a chance for them to work together. He even developed his first bromance there when he locked eyes with another Guillaume and eventually his wife Sandrine on the way home one day on the BART.
Over the years living in Oakland, they shared 4 different apartments where they hosted guests from across the US and France, not to mention Thanksgivings, Halloweens, New Year's parties, many dinners, and more than a few Game of Thrones nights. They strengthened and formed more friendships. Guillaume eventually left his post as macaroonist-in-chief and began working in the main office of the Renaissance International School in Oakland, where he forged strong relationships with students, their families, and his many beloved co-workers. During his off time, he enjoyed a range of eclectic hobbies, which drew on his passions and talents, from hiking and biking to photography and bookbinding. He even developed a love of baseball.
Deep to left field, down the line, adios, pelota!
Over the years, Laura and Guillaume enjoyed trips to Hawaii, Iceland, and Italy, as well as many trips back to France and across California.
In the winter of 2020, Guillaume really missed out on being able to celebrate his 40th birthday thanks to the COVID-19 pandemic that's still sweeping the globe. Less than a year later, he started noticing some strange fatigue that wouldn't go away. And shortly after, he was diagnosed with a very dangerous form of leukemia. But in the 9 months that followed, he spent a lot of his time at Kaiser in Oakland, which was luckily just a 10-minute walk away from the apartment. And, you know, unsurprisingly, he was adored by his doctors and nurses and all of the staff, and he would greet them warmly and crack jokes with them, even when he was feeling utterly terrible. He even befriended his IV bag, who he later named Gomez. That's the Guillaume that I know and love.
Apart from a month-long lockdown during a COVID surge, Laura visited him every day and sometimes spent the night in the hospital. When his cancer went into remission in October, Guillaume and Laura enjoyed 2.5 wonderful months with him back home. His family was able to visit from France, and they shared a Franco-American Thanksgiving, a dangerously close encounter with an elephant seal in Point Reyes, many meals, discussions, and walks. That December, after sharing one last Christmas together with family, where his presence was treated like the gift that it was, he was admitted to Stanford. His treatment there was unsuccessful.
Aside from maybe getting to share one last opening day of baseball with him, to my mind, there are only a very few silver linings that we can glean, but they're important nonetheless. One of those is that a man who represented a light and a wellspring of love could end his experience in this world surrounded by people who could reflect and radiate back that love and light to him. The other is that in his final days, he revealed something that we should probably all affix to the foundations of this thing that we call ourselves, and that is that if you live an honest, patient, and kind existence like the one that Guillaume exhibited almost every day of his life, you can almost be certain when it's time for us to conclude our own business that we will be left with very few regrets. Guillaume was frustrated that he didn't have the energy that he needed to say all of the things he wanted to say to all the important people in his life at the end. But I assured him, and I hope you will all agree with me, that there is no need, because we already know it all. So let's carry him with us, always.